this week on To the Contrary.
First, is the president paying his female staff fairly? Then, new research finds microcredit is not the magic wand it's been touted as to reduce poverty. Behind the headlines, are online hackers anonymous helping or hurting women's causes?
Welcome to the Contrary, a discussion of news and social trends from diverse perspectives. Up first, the White House pay gap.
Does President Obama practice what he preaches? Former HP president and Republican presidential candidate Carly Fiorina reignited the pay equity debate this week. Fiorina confronted Obama senior advisor Valerie Jarrett, charging the president is not paying women equally by his own measures in his own White House. Jarrett refuted the charge, saying White House women staffers are paid equally. They're both sort of right. According to White House salary data released last July, the average male staffer earns just more than $88,000 per year. The average female staffer earns just more than $78,000 per year. The reason, as Fiorina referenced, is that men are likely to be in more senior positions.
So, Congresswoman Norton, this debate took place in reaction to his comments during State of the Union. Will it ignite a new debate over pay equity?
Bonnie, I say bring it on. As long as my Republican colleagues refuse to pass the very modest update of the Equal Pay Act that is 50 years old, we need that debate.
I actually think this debate about how women are paid in the White House is sort of useless, and I think we have a more constructive way of dealing with the issue.
I think the debate's going to continue, and it's up to women to make sure that it continues.
I think if Fiorina runs for president, then this will definitely be front and center. But other than that, I think most people have forgotten what was in the State of the Union at all.
Okay, maybe.
Are you saying women don't care about equal pay?
I'm saying that most people probably didn't watch the State of the Union.
Well, forget about the State of the Union, just the debate over equal pay, which, by the way, there were figures out, I think it was last week, maybe this week, showing that it's now 82 cents to the dollar, up from 77. Now, we should caution, it has gone up and down over the
years. Here's a better answer. There are mostly men running for president, and I think that most of those men will not bring this issue up during the presidential debate.
Oh, I disagree.
Most of the men on the Republican side.
I disagree. You need the women's vote. The Republicans need the women's vote, and the Democrats need the women's vote. Right. And if we as women want to keep this dialogue going, we can keep this dialogue going.
Let me add something. I think the reason I like Carly Fiorina very much, but I think that going after the White House is sort of silly. It's playing politics, right? The reality is, I think we should talk about how large the wage gap really is. I think I suspect it's much, much smaller than we are talking about. And then how do we actually address it? Are there things that women can do? Are there things that businesses can do to try to shrink it? I don't think we'll ever be able to totally close it, because I think women's choices and men's choices are different. That's okay in my book, but I think that trying to go after this is all partisan politics, and I think it's
I agree with you. Because the fact is that, for example, in the White House, they were also talking apples and oranges, because the women who are in leadership posts, of course, make as much, and the women who are not in leadership posts make as much. But then the question is, why aren't there more women in leadership posts?
Well, and it's I think it's a legitimate question. Of all places, the Obama White, or what is he going to say? We couldn't find as many qualified senior women as men.
The mistake they made. Well, you know, when you're talking about the gap, you point out this 82 cents or whatever. Mm-hmm. You ought to concede that, and this is a very important concession, that the difference really comes if you take out all of the factors that the Republicans are talking about. You have a much smaller wage gap, to be sure. But if you take out, yes, you're absolutely right. As long as women are staying at home and preferring to do that, you're going to have part of the gap that way. So if you take all of those factors out, economists say there is still a wage gap. The difference is it is much smaller than the 82 cents that we talk about all the time.
But I agree with you, Bonnie. I mean, if you're going to be a leader in this, you need to look at the makeup of the people that are working for you, particularly in the White House, and be conscious of color, of gender, of all kinds of things, that you need to have diversity in that White House, and you need to be as equal and as fair as possible, and who's occupying senior level positions.
Well, to their credit, they have almost as many women in the top posts as men. So if and that
really,
is,
I thought
that's what I learned.
But the reports have all been that his inner circle is a whole bunch of men, like 12
but if you
men,
look at the pay.
And Valerie Jarrett.
Well, yeah, this is where
inner circle
only has,
is very different from in the top post.
I was saying he only has three senior advisors. One of them's a woman, and two of them are men. And then one of the men is leaving, and he replaced that person with a man. And so I will just say that I think it is a little bit hypocritical of this specific White House, which has pushed this issue so hard, pushed diversity so hard, to be in this position where they don't have as many women working in senior levels.
This is where I think we also have to be realistic. I mean, I went and spoke to a group of female chiefs of staff on the Hill, and I mean, listening to them, it is hard. It is very, very hard to work those long hours, and most of them all had children and more on the way, and I thought they were struggling with this. This is not the easiest job in Washington to have, and there are many other opportunities that provide much more flexibility, much higher pay. So we have to think, you know, is it that they're women
but
just
they don't get those opportunities unless they get, unless they serve on the Hill senior positions for a while.
You need to serve on those positions for a while, but I can understand why people may not want to always end up in the White House.
But you're the pending legislation. And the pending legislation is really about things like if you speak to some employers, keep you from telling your colleagues how much you make, he can fire you for that. That's really what the pending legislation
illegal.
Is about. It's not already illegal. That's what the Fair Pay Act is all about. In other words, it's so modest, it doesn't do very much about equal pay for equal work.
So you're saying,
Republicans oppose it.
Okay, so you're saying put the issue back on the Republicans, in other words, for not
updating the law?
That's
where it is, because there's pending legislation of that very modest kind I've just spoke of. They oppose it, even the women on the House side oppose it.
This is why, though. First of all, you are already allowed to talk about your salary. You go for another job interview, people are allowed to ask you what
you
are
not on the
job.
You may be fired if you do.
And second of all, I think that we are much better off talking to women and saying, hey, if salary is going to be the most important thing that you're going to value, then let's think about what you're doing. Do you want to be an engineer major, or do you want to be an English major? Do you want to work full-time, or do you want to work part-time? Do you want to start a family right away, or do you want to delay it? Those are all things that we can talk about, and that will have a much bigger impact on shrinking that gap than any kind of legislation we can
pass. Well, I just have to say, I don't know how you do that. I think, in a perfect world, that would be great. When you say start talking to women, you're talking about at the collegiate level, like saying, you're going to have better benefits if you go into English than you are if you go into engineering. That's not necessarily true, because we don't have mandatory leave like we should have for women to not lose their job and lose their places. And how do you know that a school is going to give you something better than an engineering company is going to give you? How are you going
to
know
that? I don't think you necessarily need people. I wouldn't tell my daughters to think about salary first. I would tell them to think about what's going to make them happiest and what they're going to enjoy, because I think that's how you're ultimately the most successful. But if they said, Mom, all I care about is the highest salary I can make, then I would say, you know what? Don't be a history major like Mom. That's not going to be your best, solution for making a lot of money.
And certainly some professions are known to make more money on average than other professions. And
it's all the women's fault, understand.
No, it's not all women's fault. They have agency.
All right, let us know what you think about this. Please follow me on Twitter at Bonnie Urband, @ToTheContrary. From equal pay to world poverty.
Microcredit has long been considered key to lifting women and children out of poverty in undeveloped nations. But now studies in 6 countries have found these small loans may not work. The loans have been given to impoverished but eager entrepreneurs who have no collateral or credit history. That to help them start small businesses. The research finds while small business ownership increases in the short term, it does not lead to higher incomes long term, increased investment, or children's education, or even to women's empowerment. Microcredit was pioneered by the Grameen Bank in Bangladesh, but has recently become popular here in the U.S.
One of the most depressing things about this the surveys that came out this week was that one economist was quoted as saying, there's not as much difference between the the use of these loans and the level of financial education among Africans, you know, who don't even live in cities, live out in the bush, and Americans of low income. So is that why the small loans don't work for people?
I found that very startling, but I'm very cautious right now about these studies and saying they're failures. What they talked about was they're not living up to the expectations. And when you look at how long we've been giving these loans and credit, it's not that long to start seeing results. I mean, we've seen with immigrants that have come into this country, it can take a second generation, perhaps a third generation, before you see the results of upward mobility. So I'm very cautious about taking this and saying, oh, they're failures. I've been to Ethiopia twice, seen women who have taken advantage of this, are starting small businesses. They have some more flexibility. They have an ability to control their lives more. And I think we can certainly look at this and say how to make it better. Mm-hmm. How can we tweak it? Are there other opportunities that we can additionally have? But I'm not going to say this is a failure.
Yeah, I think that's actually it's a healthy perspective. We don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater, so to speak. I think one of the things that's coming out from all of this is that there's more that's necessary than simply the financing, right? We need to have a country that has private property rights. We need to have a country that has some basic infrastructure. We talk about our infrastructure here, but it's a joke compared to what we're actually looking at, where places that don't have roads or any kind of real transportation system. We need to have some
It boils down to education.
Right.
And it's a failure on the part of our country to educate our lowest income people. You would think that we could do a better job than very underdeveloped or not developed nations, right. But we're not.
No, and you know, my views on that, I think that there's much, much more we can do than pour money into our education system. I think we need to give people real choice.
So. Well, you know, they got plenty of choices. You know, if you can get what it takes to take those choices. I certainly would not say that this is a failure, and I couldn't agree with you more. Long-term studies tells us whether or not something is a success or a failure. The most disappointing...
Well, you're talking about here, because the studies were long-term in developing countries.
Well, I wouldn't call those long-term. Is this more than 10 years?
2003, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. What bothered me, frankly, of the various failures here was, and of course this is hard to measure, but they said it, that there wasn't an increased empowerment. I would have thought that women who would have had their own businesses, who taken control of their own lives in that way, would have felt more empowered even if they failed. So that bothered me more than the kinds of failures that I would describe as simply the kind of economic failures that small businesses have anyway.
Well, one of the things I was looking at is the way some of these programs are structured, and that to me is where potentially they're failing at in a way is some of them they're just kind of handing out cash and they're not telling people these are the goals that you have to meet, these are the things that you need to be doing, you need to be strategically and financially planning. And you can't even go to a bank in America and ask for a loan for a small business and just say, I want the money, I'm not sure what I'm going to use it for, but I'm sure I can make it work. And I think that perhaps they should adopt some more of those practices, not make it harder for people to get the money, but at least be able to come in with a plan and be able to say what they're going to do with the money, they probably have a much better chance of meeting the correct outcome.
And I'm sorry.
I was just going to say, I see what you're saying. This is kind of some small amounts of money. We're looking at like $2,500, you know.
Well, even in the U.S., $1,800, but up to $50,000.
Right, which is big. Mm-hmm. But, you know, when you look at the examples they were giving, I mean, women have been creative. They've gone out there, bought jewelry for this price, then they bring it to their home. They're selling it out of their homes. They're getting clothes at a discount from a secondhand used store. They're selling it out of their homes. They're sending it to relatives in another country to go ahead and market it there and send the money back to them. So they're being very creative. I don't know what the criteria would be. And when you're looking at women who have never done any business before, I mean, that's part of the problem. If you have a plan like that, then maybe you could go to a bank
and get
that. But in this
country, really, you know, I agree with you about business plans and so forth. Well, guess what? They've had them in this country. They do give those extras that are very important to succeeding, and still we don't see much different.
And I think one of the challenges is that when the money comes in, especially because it's small amounts, it very often is consumed right away. It has to be used to buy that fabric or something. So it's not used to build assets or to build sort of wealth in the business the way when you get to a certain
size.
How
can you build wealth in a business with $1,800?
Well, that's what I mean. You simply can't, which I think is part of the challenge.
They found that, you know, things like saving and credit or what are most important for somebody who's in a small
family. If you look at the, like, looking at the examples that you were talking about, one of them was people who buy Mary Kay products, for example, and then go out and sell those. So you could use that $1,800, buy a bunch of product. That's all great and dandy, but you need to have a network, at least of women, that you could sell that product to. And that's what I'm talking about, having a business plan, like sitting down and saying, okay, I have 25 women that I know I can call on and, you know, whatnot and so forth. And I think some people are just buying product and saying, oh, I'm sure I'll be able to sell it, not really thinking through to the end goal.
I thought the one thing that was very interesting, though, was some people are not putting it in their business at all. They're realizing that their credit is a problem and they make such little money that they're putting the money aside and then paying off their debts every month to build credit. And I thought that's really smart, because then you can go to a bank or some other lender and get a loan.
More sizable loan, too.
All right, so we're all agreed we're not prepared to give up on Microsoft.
No, we're all agreed.
All right, behind the headlines, the hacking group Anonymous provokes fear in many people, but others see this loose network of people as champions of important social causes. They have been central to many stories lately surrounding sexual assault and police brutality. We spoke with anthropologist Gabriella Coleman, an expert on Anonymous, to find out who's behind those masks and how women are involved.
Anonymous is a little bit hard to define, but currently the name is primarily used to organize protest action. The name is used by different groups of individuals and groups, some of them geeks, some of them hackers, some of them unknown parties, to organize very diverse forms of collective action.
Gabriella Coleman is an anthropologist who has infiltrated Anonymous, a secretive hacking group. She's become an unofficial liaison between the group and the general public. The group's current concern is using the internet, social media, and hacking to promote specific causes.
Anonymous has been involved in over 300 political operations in the last 3 years. They've been involved in Occupy, the Arab Spring, quite recently Ferguson, involving kind of police brutality, a number of rape cases in North America, quite famously Steubenville. They've been involved in many international operations, for example, fighting corruption in the Peruvian government.
But their methods are seen as questionable.
The political operations within Anonymous take many different forms, but one of the interventions is what's called doxing. And that's when a name of an alleged perpetrator is released to the world at large. That could be, for example, an alleged rapist.
But this type of behavior is risky.
The best example of this recently has to do with the police shooting in Ferguson, where we didn't know the name of Darren Wilson. Someone within Anonymous claimed to have found out the correct name of the police officer, released it to the world at large, and it was the wrong name.
Feminist groups and others fighting against sexual assault are ambivalent about assistance from Anonymous, which has been credited with bringing national attention to otherwise ignored rape cases.
The reaction from feminists and different organizations that work on fighting sexual abuse has been mixed. It's been very mixed. Some groups and individuals stand by Anonymous for helping to spark a national debate, for helping to extend what are often local or regional issues to become national issues. In other cases, they think that they do more harm because by exposing the names of perpetrators who have yet to be charged as guilty, they're engaging in vigilante justice.
Another source of friction is Anonymous's use of offensive language. The group's original purpose before it turned to politics was merely to engage in an intense form of pranking known as trolling.
The roots of Anonymous lie in the fearsome world of internet trolling. And trolling can span from the lighthearted to the truly gruesome. And it is a culture in which there is a lot of misogyny and racism.
Partly due to this culture and the low number of women studying computer science, the vast majority of the expert hackers within Anonymous are men, but women do play important roles.
When you go outside of the sphere of just the hacker crews, the diversity is even more pronounced, and you definitely do have quite a few women involved who took on very important organizational roles. So, for example, in anonymous Twitter is very important, and there's some very big Twitter accounts, and the largest one is called Your Anonymous News. It currently has over 1 million followers. Well, two women at two different times were incredibly important in building up that account.
Does Anonymous help women or hurt them? It depends on who you ask.
I find Anonymous garners very different types of reactions. Some people, you know, find them to be really exciting and they're not scared by them at all. And then on the other side of the spectrum, people are quite concerned and find them to be kind of like goblins, scary goblins out there who are doing a lot of damage.
So goblins or crusaders for justice, which is it?
Well, you know, at this table, I am probably the wrong person to ask that question, because as someone who works in the media, I obviously think that the media should be the gatekeeper for a lot of this type of information, because people in the media have the opportunity to vet it and make sure that it's accurate and true before putting it out there, and that's why they continue to be the gatekeeper.
You know, the problem people have with anonymity is accountability. You know, when I think of the analogy, frankly, for me it's an analogy, what the huge contributors are doing when they are essentially destroying our democracy and we don't even know who they are. The notion I ask is, you know, if I don't know where the information is coming from, do I know if it's credible and do I know how to value it?
Also, these are such serious issues if we're talking about rape or we're talking about police brutality. The idea that we're sort of going after shock value rather than really a substantive, you know, investigation and then a conversation about it is very concerning.
All right, so, but let's say you want it stopped. How do you stop it? You don't stop.
You're asking the Luddite
like
here.
A million and a half
when you don't
followers.
Know who they are, they're anonymous. Well, I think what, the genie's out of the bottle, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, right.
The genie's out of the bottle. And the only
and these
thing-
are the kinds of things that, to me, make the internet sometimes a very scary place.
Well, yeah, and I know we're going to discuss how this affects women, but just, you know, being from St. Louis and being there on the ground in the Ferguson issue in the case, the person that was identified as the police officer that wasn't the police officer, his life was threatened. Yeah. I mean, it was scary. His credit cards were shut down. He went into hiding. You know, then they hack into the...
Was he ever hurt? Or?
No, but there were a lot of threats. And, of course, there's no protection for him.
Right.
And then, you know, the court system stopped working. And there was hysteria going on that they were shutting down everything, trying to hack in. Darren Wilson's family had to, you know, go into hiding. Now, eventually, the police officer's name would have been released. Mm-hmm. Okay? That's what I'm saying. I'm not saying it shouldn't have been. It's how you do it, when you do it, and that you got the facts
and Did the police end up being the ones who released the accurate name?
Yes, and which they had to do faster.
If they had done it faster.
I agree with that. I agree.
And as a former judge, how would you?
Oh,
should
I
they be
done
sanctioned?
So much differently. Don't. You'll get me in trouble.
No, I'm talking about the anonymous part of it. Is there a way to sue the group? To criminalize the group somehow?
Yeah, I know. I was thinking about that, and I think it would be very difficult to criminalize them. I mean, some of them have been prosecuted.
They have
been able to go in and find them when they were, you know, for hacking under federal guidelines and getting into certain records.
Well, this is part of the
I'm just curious because I didn't know that. Yeah. Are they in jail?
I think it's in the process. I don't think anybody has been convicted yet. I think there are charges.
And there are speech issues involved.
I was going to say, this is one of the reasons why the White House and the federal government are pursuing better cybersecurity legislation to stop the hacking from occurring, which would stop the problem that we're talking
about.
And
my problem is with women and how this goes with vigilantism going towards, you know, rape, alleged rapists and things.
And women have been real victims in gaming. Women got into gaming. And there have been the most horrendous incidents reported where they were not just hacked, they were threatened with their lives because many of these anonymous people happen to be men and happen to be misogynists.
Mm-hmm. And some of it, I mean, there's no screening for crazy either, right?
No, that's very true. And so then you have to wonder, is this, you're going to be a backlash on what we're trying to do on women reporting, mm-hmm. credibility issues. Are people going to go, you know what, accusations are flying about rape, sexual assault everywhere, and you start to be desensitized and feel like they're not valid? I mean, I don't know how that's going to happen, but I think it's something that's worth watching.
All right, that's it for this edition. Please follow me on Twitter and visit our website, pbs.org/to the contrary. And whether you agree or think to the contrary, See you next week.
It doesn't, you know, it doesn't matter to me that any of these might be considered to be progressive. A lot of this, because if you're against it, you're against it.